Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, on the behalf of the Board of Directors of the European Liberal Forum, I would like to welcome you to this Ralph Dahrendorf Roundtable on For Europe. Talk for Europe, not just about Europe. And I would also like to extend my warm welcome to our distinguished speaker, to Mr. Guy Verhofstadt, the leader of the ALDE group in the European Parliament. To Mr. Andrej Babiš, the leader of ANO party here and finance minister. And of course, the moderator of this panel, Mr. Pavel Telička, the MEP. Well, as you might know or might not know, European Liberal Forum is the non-profit political foundation of European liberals. And we consist of, I think now, 37 think tanks, political institutions, research institutes all over the EU. But our activities also extend beyond the borders of the European Union, specifically in the European neighborhood. We mainly support, perhaps also initiate, and perhaps also influence the European public policy issues and organizing such debates, but also have our own publications, so I invite you to look at our website. But today we have heard a lot about Europe, and I hope this talk will be more a talk for Europe. It seems to me that from its beginning, when the European Union was established, with a dream, as we heard from Ilya, for prosperity, with a dream to keep peace, there was some kind of a tension already at the beginning of two trends, and we've heard also political philosophy, one maybe coming from Spinelli, the other maybe represented more by Winston Churchill on Kantian perpetual peace. But are they still present? Should we move more towards supranationalism, or is the movement that we see now more closed within the nation state again? So I hope that discussion will also be according to these lines. I think there was some thought about federalism expressed today. Yes, could we find a model which would actually make, maybe Angela Merkel would say, European Union better, big on big issues, smaller on smaller issues. So a model which could, on the one hand, make Europe a player in the global world, which is transforming, and also respond to concerns, wishes, and ambitions of all of us who constitute the European Union. Either states, regions, local communities, and of course, as a liberal, I should say, an individual. So we expect a very vivid debate, and I would give the floor to you, Mr. Telička.
Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We are a bit pressed by time because Ms. Verhofstadt is here on the occasion of an off-site ALDE group strategic meeting, which in fact starts just in over an hour. So I think we should skip long comments from my side at the very beginning and make the best out of it. I was a little bit tempted when we have just heard we want Europe big on big issues and small on small issues. Sometimes I wonder that some people don't even know what the issues are. And if they know whether they are able to, let's say, have a certain degree of coherence of what the issues are, and definitely have the courage and the ability to address the right issues and be decisive, and if they decide to implement it. But in order not to prolong the very beginning, I would make the best use of these two excellent panelists. I think we'll give a little bit more time to Guy, being a visitor and, let's say, someone that we don't have a daily well, I do, but not necessarily everyone in this room, to confront the ideas with. We have heard numerous times the crisis in which Europe is. We had a summit just a few days ago in Bratislava. The first, let's say, reports were it went pretty well. And already today we hear that Renzi and Merkel and I don't know who else had nearly a fight there. So, Guy, I think what we would appreciate is have your take on the EU today, where we stand, what are the issues, where do we go from here on, what are really the issues to be addressed, how to do it, are we able to do it? And in fact, we would also like to pick your brain on what kind of the EU we should have. And I know that many would say federal, others would say different, but I think that we need to dig a little bit beneath that to really address the real issues and the core issues. So can we ask you for a short introduction on these issues or any other that you would like to emphasize? Thank you.
This in 5 minutes or something like
oh,
that.
Oh, you're so. Asking for you're asking for far much due time, so let's say...
Thank you very much, first of all, for the invitation. It's not the first time that I'm here in this room debating with you the future of the European Union. And maybe let me start, Pavel, by picking up the discussion of this morning, who was apparently a discussion of need we go in the direction of Spinelli or need we go in the direction of Winston Churchill. I don't know if there was so big difference. Because Winston Churchill, the man who said, oh, we need the United States of Europe. And that's what exactly also the direction that Spinelli wanted to go. The only difference was that Spinelli wanted that Italy was part of the United States of Europe. And Winston Churchill didn't want that Britain was part of the United States of Europe. So they had the same idea, but not the same, idea on the membership of their country. But the fact that and Spinelli and Winston Churchill and all the other founding fathers had the same idea about the future of the European Union was not by a coincidence. It was their experience after the Second World War. Possible to continue like that. It's impossible to return to the pre-war time with the concert of Europe type of policies. We need a supranational Europe to build up. And that doesn't mean the disappearance of the nation states. On the contrary, that means a system in which the nation states and the peoples of Europe work together in a supranational framework so that we can better defend our interest worldwide, and at the same time avoid war atrocities that we have seen for so many decades. That was their idea. There was no difference between Monet and Schumann and De Gasperi and Spinelli and even Winston Churchill and the other founding fathers. Moreover, their first idea that they got was a constitution in 1953 that they have put together, a constitution approved by the representatives of the six founding fathers at that moment, so the three countries of the Benelux, Italy, France, and Germany. And in that constitution, they build up a European Union already at that moment with the defense community. Now everybody's talking about the defense community. They got it already in place in 53. With the European Parliament, directly elected, we have put it on only in place in 1979 and not in 1953. With their own budget, with a full budget, not the half budget we know today. With a political union, also another topic. And I wrote a book about that old constitution, under the title The Disease of Europe in America. It will sound a little bit more positive, Europe's Last Chance. And I have found out, in fact, that what happened in the 50s was, in fact, nearly a tragedy. We got everything in place, the six founding fathers, also with the approval of of Great Britain and of Winston Churchill at that time had the idea to build up Europe as a political union with a defense community capable to defend its interest worldwide. And it failed. Why it failed? By an accident. A political accident can happen. It failed in the French National Assembly in 1954, where the proposal was disapproved by a majority in that National Assembly for one reason, because the Prime Minister, the new Prime Minister at that time, that was Pierre Mendès-France, the leader of the Radical Party, and he was the new Prime Minister. This proposal was a proposal of his predecessor, and he didn't want to put the confidence vote in the French National Assembly to go through with the project. And what happened was that the whole proposal, approved by the representatives of the six member states, was falling, and that the remaining representatives of the six member states came then later together and have made the Treaty of Rome in 1957, and we're going to have the 16th anniversary of this Treaty of Rome next year on the 25th of March. And what this Treaty of Rome? Nearly a customs union. Not more than that. Not the political union, defense community, the European Union, as was imagined by the founding fathers of Europe. And I'm telling you that story for one reason, that it is that, in my opinion, instead of having big summits in Bratislava and in other cities in Europe, what we need to do is simply to go back to the initial dream and the initial proposals of the founding fathers of the European Union. Because if that system, if their proposals were today in place, we can solve the main challenges we face today with Europe. Take, for example, what's happening in Syria, where Europe doesn't play a role, no role at all. It are the Americans and the Russians who make peace or not peace or a ceasefire. I don't know what they are doing, because they make a ceasefire, but they are continuing to bomb, in fact, in a number of areas. But no European Union representative around the table. Nevertheless, it is Europe who is facing the main problems of the crisis in Syria, the refugees, the migrants, the instability, and so on. The same, so if we had a defense community already in place in the 50s, we should not be so absent on the geopolitical and world level as we are today. It's completely depending from what the Russians are saying and what the Americans are playing, or vice versa. The same is happening on economics. Look, for example, the financial crisis. I know maybe it's a bad environment to tell that, because I know that Czechia and Mr. Babiš have good economic results here, so Czechia is not an example of what is happening for the moment in the European Union. But in the meanwhile, Europe is still facing the fallout of a financial crisis that has been solved in America in 2-3 years. And we are still facing the fallout of it. For example, in the south of Europe, bad economic results. For example, unstable financial institutions and banks in Italy, even in Germany, in Spain, and in Greece, not to give only a few examples. The Americans did everything with their system in 9 months. They put in place an investment fund of $900 billion. They did TARP, that was the recapitalization of their banks, in a few months, $400 billion. They did quantitative easing, $1.3 trillion, all decided by Republicans and Democrats together in their system in 9 months, and in 2014, the last dollar that have been put by the American state in the system to solve the financial crisis have been paid back by bank, insurance companies, and by the industry. We are still facing the problems of the financial crisis, and we can be lucky that we have Mario Draghi in the ECB to give a certain stability to our system, because in the meanwhile, the gaps in Europe between the economies are only growing and not becoming smaller and smaller. Third example, the migration crisis. Can you imagine that America, for example, I give again the example of America, that's maybe because there are elections there that I'm doing that, is managed as Europe is managed. That the decisions are taken not by Obama of the American administration, but by the 50 governors of the United States deciding together. Where, for example, San Francisco or California is saying, oh, we don't participate in the euro. We're going to continue with the dollar. We're going to continue with the peseta, because the peseta was long time the currency of California. Or where Florida is saying, oh, the American Coast Guard, oh, we don't participate. We can do it better than the American Coast Guard. Or Oregon is saying, oh, FBI, oh, we don't trust the FBI. We don't participate. That is happening in Europe. I tell you, the European Union doesn't exist in reality. It's a confederation, a loose confederation of nation states, in which every decision has to be taken by 28 and in the future by 27. And where it is sufficient that one is saying no and everything is blocked. The recapitalization of our banks, the launch of an investment program to tackle the financial crisis, one or other European border and coast guard, I don't can understand that if you have Schengen and if you have one area in which you can move freely, travel freely, then you need at least also one European border and coast guard to control who is entering, who can enter, who cannot enter, who will be sent back. What is still not the case in Europe. Everybody is doing it on its own or is not doing it, like, for example, is happening in Greece for a long time. So my point is that if we want to overcome this crisis, we need not to create a super state Europe. That's absolutely not needed. We need to do the things that are needed. Defense community, European border and coast guard, common governance of the Eurozone, and that we need to be at the same time less presence in the small rules we create every day with this whole system in Brussels. Do we need 28 commissioners? I say no, we don't need 28 commissioners. If tomorrow there is a 29th or a 30th country becoming member of the European Union, so they can then have a commissioner. Well, we don't even have portfolios to give to that commissioner. I am pretty sure that we need to go back to the initial idea that was a commission of 12 people, a government for Europe, small, but busy with the important tasks, migration issue, border control, defense policy, economic governance of the Eurozone, and not publishing every day, producing every day, more and more rules that make Europe in a whole less competitive than the other parts of the world. That is what we need. I know I may be more critical towards the European Union today than all the Eurosceptics together. And there are a number of them, the Eurosceptics. But I think it's absolutely needed to recognize what is going well, but certainly also to recognize and underline what is going wrong. And to put a vision forward that can work for the future, instead of repeating again and again a summit in the four corners of Europe and saying, yeah, we're going to implement better this and implement better that. No. The reality is the following. If you don't want to buy my book, I can say to you there is another book that's very interesting. And it's a book of two Americans, Why Nations Fail. Why Nations Fail is a fantastic book for a politician. Of Akamoglu and Robinson. Why it is a fantastic book for a politician? Because they are mainly saying, no, it's not about the economy, stupid. It's about politics, stupid. So for a politician, that's a very important message that we are that we are important, that it is that we are crucial in a society. And what they are in fact explaining is that if you have not the right institutions in place, you cannot recover. You cannot be wealthy. They give not only the example of North and South Korea, could be a good example. They give the example, for example, of Nogales, a small city on the border between Mexico and the U.S. And the north of the city lives in the U.S. And the south of the city lives in Mexico. And the border goes straight to Nogales. And the people in the north are five times more wealthier than in the south. How is it possible? Well, the same families. They eat the same food, Mexican food. Spicy, in any way. And in any way, what you see, they are five times more wealthy. What is the difference? Same climate, same families, same disease, same DNA. The difference is the political institutions that create wealth in the north and that create corruption, inequality, poverty in the south. And that is the lesson to take. It's about politics. We need to have the right institutions in place, otherwise Europe will never recover. And to do so, we need to do it as fast as possible, not to wait any longer. To wait for what? I don't know what. What we need is to take our own fate in our hands and then to rebuild Europe the fastest as possible, along the lines and of Winston Churchill and of Spinelli. Thank you.
One of the more famous speeches of Guy Verhofstadt, I'm sure that some of those are famous, even breaking deals as concerns Greece, etc. But I'm a little bit puzzled because and concerned at the same time, because I can see already the headlines for tomorrow when some of the Czech Eurosceptics are being happy. As you have said, in fact, the European Union does not exist. I think that that will make a lot of people happy. We need to rectify it to some extent. But I think the message was clear. And I think that my understanding is that Guy Verhofstadt is not happy with the outcome of the Bratislava summit. He didn't see the right decisions with the timetable that he would have liked to have, and probably some of the missiles missing the target. But we'll come back to that. But that would be my assumption. I think the key word that I would extrapolate from that would be the political and economic governance. Now, Mr. Babiš, we know what Spinelli wanted. We know what Churchill wanted. We have just listened to Guy Verhofstadt. And I would appreciate to have your take. Especially on how you see the current situation in the EU and whether the medicine that is really needed is the one that Guy Verhofstadt has put forward, or would there be, let's say, medicaments on which you would differ? Thank you.
So thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. So Guy confirmed he's the best speaker in European Parliament, so for me it's quite difficult to comment on this issue because I'm quite short in politics and I can comment, of course, on my own experience. So yesterday was summit, same comments, same blah blah blah. It's if you make monitoring of all these summits, I mean the speech of Hollande or Merkel is more or less the same. So no decision. There will be a next summit in March and there will be again speeches. And I don't think it's the problem of Europe is about institutions. It's about the people and about the persons, and it's always the same in business, in companies, in politics. So one is clear that the actual European leaders will difficultly solve the problem of Europe because they were not capable to solve the migration. And today at the lunch I learned that practically no agreement with Turkey. I saw there is some written agreement and I was asking my prime minister over several times during the government, give me this agreement, I want to read it. And I learned there is no agreement, there is just some press statement. It's unbelievable. So we are going to give money to Turkey, 3 billion euro, without any agreement. For me, I'm really still more businessman than the politician, so it's something crazy. Europe, Common Europe was or is an excellent project. I mean, we after the Second World War, we wanted to have a peace and freedom, and we wanted to defend our continent, and we wanted to free circulation of goods and capital and labor, and we didn't reach it practically after so long time. And everybody is speaking of the forcing of borders and Frontex, so the question is why they don't do it. So I said already, I don't know, in August last year, that we have to have the same Schengen border like we have between Slovakia and Ukraine, or Poland and Ukraine. And after the problems which happened in Hungary, Mr. Orban also make a border. So why the Ukraine refugee or worker have to wait 6 to 9 months for the working permit in Czech Republic? We have the lowest unemployment rate today in Europe, and the other ones which are coming now through Italy, they don't need any passport, any visa, nothing. So that's why first we have to defend our continent. The question is, if you look at the map, why Greece is in Schengen, why we don't have all European countries in Schengen, we have to defend the continent. And nobody can come shouldn't come to Europe without any invitation to work or to be, or is coming for humanitarian reasons. This is the base. And it was really funny yesterday because everybody was happy with the summit. Only the Italian Prime Minister said he even refused to go to the press conference with Madame Merkel and Mr. Hollande. And he said finally we have to find our own solution, because the incapability of Europe is leading to that the individual countries are taking measures independently from Europe, like Hungary, they build a fence, and maybe Mr. Renzi will make his solution on his own. So this is the base, and we didn't solve this problem. So we didn't learn nothing about the immigration in United States or Canada or Australia, Ellis Island. We made hotspots inside of Europe. I don't know why we don't have hotspots outside in Turkey. We need the Ellis Island, Turkey. And the solution is the peace in Syria. We need a peace in Syria. This is the base, and we should work on it 24 hours a day. 20 million people left Syria. And if we have the peace in Syria, then we can make a Marshall Plan for Syria. And all European companies will profit from this reconstruction of Syria, maybe Libya also. So this is the key, and somebody has to say loudly that we really cannot accept any of these refugees. So we have to be responsible against our citizens, our nations, and the solution is the peace in Syria. And I don't have a feeling that somebody is really working on it hardly. And the problem is, of course, all decisions of European politicians depends on elections. So, or even in the United States, these people they want to be politics and they want to be in politics, and that's why they are taking political decisions according if the elections are coming or not. They are not really solving the problem, and this is the problem. And that's why now we are waiting for U.S. elections, and then we will during the summit in March in. We will wait for maybe German or French elections, and this is not really a good approach. So they have to solve the problem independently if there are elections or not elections. So this is the problem, and I think that the actual European leaders are not capable to solve the problem of Europe, because they failed in migration. We can speak about Eurozone. They failed in Greece. Problem in Eurozone. Everybody knows Greece is bankrupt and should go out of Eurozone. And Eurozone was the economic problem, not the political one. And that's why I'm happy not to be in Eurozone, because I heard a lot about the negotiation of my colleagues, with Greek colleagues, and it was an unbelievable story. We, in Czech Republic, our banks are very healthy, we are full of money, and I hope for the equal budget, and we are reducing the debt, so we are working fine, even outside of Eurozone. So Eurozone has to change also. Why should I guarantee for Greek credits, or I don't know, for some Austrian banks, or so on? So all these examples, or the decision of Germany for to close the nuclear plants and to close coal mines, unbelievable. Officially, a lot of people in Europe are saying Putin is our enemy, and we close in nuclear plants, we close the coal mines, so to be more dependent on Russian gas. It's a very logical decision. So it's, I mean, crazy. So for me, Europe, or everything in politics, is about the people, and after the next elections, probably there will be new leaders which will come and have to solve this problem, and has mainly to realize their promises and speeches and declarations, and this is the problem. So for me, of course, the biggest issue was the VAT gap. It was unbelievable when I heard for the first time in June 2014 that Europe is losing every year 170 billion euro on VAT. And I was asking my colleagues what are you doing against this. If you would be a private company, it's an unbelievable crisis. Somebody is stealing our money. What are you doing? Nothing, zero. So after two and a half year, working hard, organizing meetings and visiting all ministers and speaking to prime ministers and presidents about this problem, we finally succeed to put it on the agenda. Two and a half year, unbelievable. And we have a good solution, this reverse charge. But Mr. Moscovici, he don't want to hear to us and all these bureaucrats in Brussels. They have, I don't know which solution, probably. And again this year, there was 165 billion euro VAT gap. So this is our concrete examples from my experience, which are of course very not very positive. So that's why I don't know why Brussels should decide about our measures against in the fight against the VAT gap. In Czech Republic, I think the Czech government should decide, and because we know it better than the people in Brussels. So, Europe, I don't want now to speculate what will happen, but it's I mean it's the same everywhere that we need action. And probably these people which are deciding today about Europe, they didn't live in crisis, in real crisis, and that's why they are not capable to have action. So if you see our relation with Turkey, it's an unbelievable story. No? I mean, Turkey, we took Turkey NATO as a front against Russia. And now, practically after this incident between Turkey and Russia, today they are quite close because they act very quickly. And the question is, of course, why Europe is not capable to act, and this is the biggest problem. So for Czech Republic, of course, we underestimate our participation in Europe from the beginning. We have sent politicians which we didn't want to have in Czech Republic just to recompensate them for their performance in Czech politics. But that's why we need to fight for our interest in Europe. We need very good people. Which are representing Czech Republic, and now of course it's improving, and we have very good, I mean, concerning our movement, we have very good members of parliament, and they can really fight for our interests. So so this is my opinion, and for me, of course, I'm sure that we can play a bigger role in Europe, like we prove it in reverse charge, because now everybody knows us in the meeting of Minister of Finance, that I am obsessed by reverse charge, and we could maybe play a bigger role even in other issues like migration and or other issues which are interesting for, you know, for Czech Republic.
Okay, thank you. Before opening the floor for debate, my understanding from the two contributions is, the EU in fact doesn't exist. From Mr. Babiš, we have heard that the internal market, in fact, not that it doesn't exist, but is highly fragmented. So clearly there is a lack of satisfaction, to say the least. A second point that I would underline is that we see a view of the need of changing the political institutions, so maybe the emphasis more on the institutional aspect, while from Mr. Babiš we have heard maybe the emphasis more on people. I think that the one doesn't work without the other. In fact, I was a little bit tempted when Guy spoke of the Spinellis, Monets, etc., that we can change the institutions, but with some of the current leaders that don't have really the ability, the courage, don't have the drive, and our focus, as you have said, too much on opinion polls, it's going to be also difficult. On the other hand, we can change all the people around, but the reality is, and you have also complained about it, how difficult it is to arrive at a certain outcome on an issue like reverse charge. So I think that in reality we are looking at the same issue from two angles, but they have a lot in common. I also understand that Mr. Babiš is not happy with the outcome of the Bratislava summit. That, of course, is not criticism of the Slovak presidency. He wouldn't do it with his origin, for sure, but I think that this is just a reality that where we really don't deliver, that whether it's migration crisis, whether it's Greek crisis, whatever it is extremely lengthy, and the words have been used of being incapable of delivering, and I think that this is to a large extent a key. Fragmentation, for sure. This also has been said. But talking about the March summit in Rome, honestly, and I know that we have all spoken about it vis-a-vis the previous summits, but I think that this is an opportunity which cannot be missed. This, for me, is not the crossroads, because we've been on the crossroads and we have left it and not necessarily always in the right direction, but we can see what the political situation in the member states is. I mean, we're far right, far left, whatever it is. Populism very high, very well, doing very well. So I really believe that this is the time by which we need to recover. I would have expected myself a bit more from the Bratislava summit, saying clearly A, B, C, and D, and having their deadlines, and this is... this is, for me, the minimum that was to be said, and I'm afraid that this has not taken place. So I'm not really too optimistic. But I think that from the two speeches, we understand that there is definitely a strong devotion to the EU, with different, let's say, emphasis, different level of maybe criticism, maybe also seeing differently the way out. But we have, I think, no other option. For the Czech Republic, a country like ours, with its open economy, but also in the center of Europe, we really don't have any other option. And I must say that when I read in The Guardian the comments of the head of state of this state, that the EU is about money, 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 Well, I'm not deeply depressed, but I'm afraid that the question that Mr. Babiš referred to, and that the politicians, I think that this will be also in this country hard nut to crack. And final remark, quite often we speak of us and the EU, and we are critical, and also you've been critical towards Brussels. I need to say that, you know, we are in co-command. And we not necessarily realize it. You realize it very well in the reverse charge, where you've got you have made a progress as lengthy as it was due to the, let's say, degree and level of governance. But I mean, all the key decisions are being taken today, rightly or wrongly so, on the heads of states level. That is a reality. And why are we where we are today? Because the summit did not deliver. It's not because the Commission didn't propose something. I mean, the Commission made a number of proposals, majority positive, some of them that I had personally real difficulties with, but this is the case, and when there is a certain development, the European Parliament is bypassed as the key, second key institution. I mean, talking about Turkey, we discussed it over lunch, well, the Parliament has been bypassed because we didn't fit into that scenario. But anyway, I'll stop here because I think that the time which remains is really for you. We've got something like 15, 20 minutes. I would really appreciate short introduction, short target question, reservation, or whatever you have, and a quick response. If you have an idea whom should respond to your point, please indicate. Please, Mazhar. We need quicker micros, and we do have one.
Thank you very much. Very, very quick point. Sometimes, I'm not trying to defend Greece, because both of the people here just mentioned something about Greece, but I think the Greek problem was very simple to solve at a certain time, and somebody didn't take a decision at the right time. So, second thing, how do you see Europe in 5 years' time? Do you see that the smaller union will come up because of the indecision of the 27, 28 to decide, or what else?
Well, I hope, Ambassador, you're getting ready for the summit, that everything will be well prepared, and we will see really a great outcome. But let's start with Guy.
Well, yeah. In fact, you have already a Europe with different speeds. Yeah? So everybody's talking about the different speeds, but what you have today is an Europe à la carte. There is no one Europe. There are some countries in Schengen, others not. There are some countries in the Euro, others not. There are some countries in the European patent, others not. There are some countries in the Plum Convention, that's about justice and home affairs, others not. I needed 12 different charts to explain the European Union. To say what European Union we are talking about. That's the reason why I make this comparison with the US, saying, can you imagine that such a system exists, for example, at the other side of the Atlantic? We should say, hey, you're crazy. So what I see is that to solve that problem, to end this Europe à la carte, what leads to a budget with 53 exceptions that nobody can understand today, and what I see is that the discussion on the Brexit can be an opportunity to solve that problem. So not only to talk about their decision, but also to talk about how it should work in the future. Again, I go back to our founding fathers. They did so. They got already, I give you that example, an associated status for countries, not for the full members. You've got full membership of associated status. That was foreseen in their proposals, adopted by the six member states. So I think it's an opportunity to solve that problem and to, in fact, reduce the complexity of the European Union, which is enormous for the moment, its complexity. Also, the use of directives and regulations and so on, the abuse of directives makes that after a few years we need a new initiative of the European Union because the directive has been used in so different ways by 20 member states that we need new action, and so on and so on. And that gives me the opportunity to say that the discussion about are the institutions or are the people, in fact, is the same for me. So I agree with Mr. Babiš that one and the other has to do with each other. I think that wrong institutions create wrong people in place. and wrong people create wrong institutions. And communism creates Stalin, while democracy created Abraham Lincoln and slavery. So the two are going together, I think. And so this struggle is absolutely necessary, not only for migration and defense, also for the internal market. Let's say to the people, the internal market of Europe concerns only 35% of our goods and services. We are talking about an internal market, and the reality is that only 35% of the goods and services are falling under the internal market. Not energy, forbidden by the treaty, not the capital market, still not in place. You need to have one credit here with an asset in the other side of Europe. There is no mortgage market, in unified mortgage market in Europe. So no capital market, not to talk about no telecom market in the reality, and no digital market. If you are a small company, if a bright young guy here in the room has a new app on internet and he wants to launch it, he needs 28 authorizations in Europe to launch it on the whole market. And he needs 120, 125 deals with mobile operators to do it. The better is to do like Spotify. There was a Swedish firm. Spotify, you know it. Well, they went to the US. And there they did a deal, one authorization from the Federal Communications Office, and at the same time, three or four agreements with the three, four big mobile operators in America, and they launched their services in all of the US. Try to do that here. That's a problem. Okay, we like 28 national operators. We like it, naturally, that the spectrum and the selling of the frequencies is done on the national level, mainly to fund the national budget and not to increase the use of modern technical devices on our internet. And then you are saying, oh, how it is possible that in the 10 biggest internet companies worldwide and in the 10 biggest high-tech companies worldwide, there is no European company. How is this possible? How is it possible? It's easy, because we don't use the internal market of more than 500 million citizens to launch a process. We are bigger than the American market, but we make it 10 times more difficult to launch a product or a service on the European market than on the American market. And then we say, oh yeah, all these big American firms who come to colonize us. Let's start to...
We'll introduce safeguard measures that they can't.
The safeguard measures, you can talk what you want. The best safeguard measure is to organize your internal market the fastest as possible. So it's not only a question, that is what I want to say, of institutions and persons. It's really to do the step we need to do. You know why the digital market was not involved when Delors started with his idea of the internal market? His idea was to do it for the whole market. And then he came into the council, and there the French and the Germans and I don't know whom said, not energy, because that's national interest. Not digital, because that is national strategic interest. And so on and so on. And finally it was champagne and chocolate who was eliminated.
Thank you, but it's, just one sentence. The regulatory environment of the internal market quite often is the main obstacle to really developing and completing the internal market. But back to the question, Mr. Babish, how do you see the EU in 5 years? Is it a la carte, or would you say what the Verhofstadt has spoken about, that in some areas, in some policies, the USA could in fact be a certain example to follow, or how do you see it?
I have the same answer like before. I mean, it depends. France will be different under Marine Le Pen or under Sarkozy or Juppé or Hollande. So I mean, it's again about the people who will lead the European countries and who will lead the Europe. Then it's the same question for Czech Republic. So we will have in 1 year and 3 weeks. Let's say key elections for the future of our country, and depending on who will succeed, then we will see. So I mean,
That's exactly it. So let's say that you succeed and you will lead the country.
No,
so
I didn't want to lead this conversation.
Conferences, seminars, and think tanks are a little bit about it. So let's assume that you would win the election, you would lead the country. So what would be your perception?
Sorry, but we were speaking about the Europe, so I would prefer to stay in Europe. Today, of course, the people have decided. We have, of course, in Europe, lots of movements which are against the traditional political parties, against the establishment, and it will. It depends. It will be more and more like in France. Emmanuel Macron now has established his party, and he's also from entrepreneur milieu, and this is the question: how these movements will succeed against the traditional parties which we have here in Czech Republic since revolution. But I don't want to speak now. Of course, it's a problem. How the electoral system is, because we unfortunately don't have the majority system like in the United States. So we have coalitions, and finally the people they don't know who make a profit for them. And now we are fighting with social democrats who found money for pensions for 300 crowns. So it's a discussion now, and it's also difficult. So it's better the one when majority system is in place. But so this is.
I understand it. I think you don't want to preempt the main points for the next elections. It will come. I think that I saw you to come next, and I would take away one more. Hello. And I'm afraid that. I'm sorry, the gentleman in the second row was second, so I would take these two gentlemen. I'm afraid that we will then have to conclude on that. I'm sorry, we are running out of time. So
thank you, Chair. Ilya Lingorsky from the European League of Economic Cooperation from Bulgaria. President Verhofstadt, congratulations on your new book. We will be very happy to see that translated and published in Bulgaria. So we will very much rely on your support and agreement with that. But I also want to congratulate you on your appointment for the Brexit representative of the European Parliament in the negotiations. How do you see your role in these negotiations in order to get your vision further and accelerated about bringing Europe back to the original vision and back to what the founding fathers you so eloquently explained, meant when they started the constitution? And a question to Minister Babiš. Minister Babiš, do you think it's time to seriously reconsider and probably scrap the cohesion policy and change it with something which will really bring in new Europe greater productivity and a real acceleration of the convergence which we need to do?
Thank you. Can you pass on the micro to the gentleman behind you? And I would really ask you for a very quick question. I'm sorry for being polite.
John Lloyd at the Financial Times. A question for both. As the previous speaker has said, Guy Verhofstadt has got a job to do on Brexit. But do you in your heart of hearts feel that it would be better, that the European Union would be better without Britain? Because many in the European Union, many who are desirous of a greater integration of Europe, see and have seen Britain as a block on that, and there's no question it has been. So would you see then the Brexit as being a chance to make an integrated Europe in the way in which it has not been able to before? So it's to both of you.
If I may ask, just ask yes or no, do you see that as an opportunity yourself?
Well, as a Brit, I'm kind of out of it, and the Prime Minister has said.
Typical opt-out.
Oh, you want my opinion? Yes, I think it would be. I think probably with Britain gone, the big question, if you ask for my opinion, is whether or not the other countries, with or without Britain, actually want to create integration. It isn't really about Britain. It's down to those people who wish to create greater integration to do it. They could have done it before.
In other words, you say it's Britain and a few others that are hiding behind Britain. That's more or less what you're saying.
Yeah.
Fine, we got it. Let's start with Mr. Babiš and the question, if I understood well, whether you would be in favor of scrapping the cohesion policy.
Yeah, it's a good question. So, of course, the best solution would be to have euro without any subsidies. And in this case, the Czech farmers would be very, very productive. But of course, I mean, these agriculture subsidies are the base of cheap food, and it's the base of European budget with France and Germany on the top. So, okay, one side, when we were, let's say, criticizing, or we didn't accept these quotas, there were some politicians which said that they will reduce these funds, but I think for us it's really totally unacceptable, because I mean we have here a lot of investors which are really they got a very cheap labor. Normally they should pay three times or four times more in their home countries, and they are receiving every year 10 billion euro dividends. So that's why, I mean, we made a deal, practically it's 50-50, and nobody can say us that we have some advantage. I don't agree with this. And on Brexit, okay, everybody is speaking about Brexit. There was so many movements on the stock immediately after the vote, but it will take, I don't know how many years, 2, 3, 4 years, and I mean, it's not really an issue for me today. For me today, it's immigration. And how Europe will move and decide in the future. But Brexit, of course, if I would be in that position like UK, and with all this experience of bureaucracy in Brussels, maybe I will also vote for.
This was a personal comment of Mr. Babiš, not necessarily shared by everyone. Well, that's why I added my comment to it. But I think that the answer is basically, if it were politically realistic, then yes, but the political reality in the EU is different. Guy, we now have two questions for you, and we need to avoid being slaughtered at 3 o'clock by our colleagues.
In fact, it's one issue that has been raised. And I like the way it was put forward, because it's true that when in 1953-54 it went wrong, Britain was not around the table. It went wrong because of a vote in the French Nationalist Assembly, not in the not by a referendum in Britain or whatever other. On the contrary, Britain was at that moment already an associated member of the steel and coal community. Nobody knows that anymore, that when we started with the European Steel and Coal Community, there was an associated relationship with Great Britain, who was consulted on nearly every topic without being represented in the assembly, of the ad hoc assembly of the European Steel and Coal Community. And when the Founding Fathers started then, based on that, their exercise for a European constitution, political union included, and a defense community, one of the big supporters of that idea was Britain, to have a united continent on political and defense matters. Also with the US. US was also a big supporter of that. And everybody was very upset that it failed in the National Assembly, and that the French wanted to reintroduce the veto right, because that was the main topic, a veto right to use the defense community when it was necessary. So I liked very much, that I think it's good to put that in an historical perspective, that from time to time when it went wrong, it went wrong because the 6 or the 10 or the 12 themselves had a lack of agreement. Like, you have also to say that it went wrong with the budget because we started with rebates, naturally. This budget is not a serious budget anymore. The budget was a budget like in every country, with a revenue and an expenditure side. And the revenue was collected by the businesses and by the citizens. VAT, taxes on agricultural products, taxes on important customs duties and so on. That was the revenue of the union by the beginning. That has all mostly disappeared. It is now a system of GNI contributions. I translated for you this by saying it's our subsidies by member states, because why it was now, why we changed it from a direct revenue, where you have a direct link with the citizens and the companies, to a system of subsidies because of the rebate, naturally. And if you have a rebate, yeah, you need to have another basis to collect your money, and that created then the budget as we have now, with tens and tens and tens of, because next to the rebate, we created a rebate on the rebate, for the Dutch and for the Swedish and for the Germans and for the Danish. And then we created for the other countries exceptional additional expenditure to compensate the rebate on the rebate. When Tony Blair made a budget, he needed 42 exceptions to have a deal. So, buying the delegations. And the last time, the last MFF, we needed 53. It's like a Turkish bazaar, more and more, the budget. In which 80% of the money we collect go back to that same countries who are paying it. Only 20% stays in the in so-called Brussels. 6% of that is needed to pay the institutions and the civil servants. So the real maneuver, room of maneuver in the budget, is 13 to 14%. So it's not 1% of the European GDP, it's 0.13 or 14% of European GDP. And then we are saying, yeah, how it is possible that this is not happening, how it is possible that that is not happening, and there is too much money there and there. We are talking about 0.14% of the European GDP. So this whole discussion, the discussion put that naturally again on the table. Is that possible? And what must be the size of this budget? Can you continue with rebates, yes or no? All this is now something that has been opened by the Brexit, even what I personally have to tell you, that I was not in favor of a Brexit. People said to me, don't go to Britain, because you're going to have a negative impact. I didn't go, so it's not my fault, the outcome of the referendum. And I, you know why, the main reason why I think it was, I don't like it, the outcome, is not economically, because economically we have seen everything. Economically, the most tragic analysis of a Brexit, the most optimistic thing, is geopolitical. Geopolitical is the main problem, I think. A divided Europe. A divided Europe in a world that is dominated tomorrow by empires. By China. China that's not a nation, that's a civilization. Han. With different ethnies. India. That's not a nation. India, that's the biggest democracy with 2,000 ethnies, with 20 languages, and with 4 big religions. And at the same time, the biggest, as I said, democracy. The U.S., everybody is talking about the U.S., that's more as a nation, but tomorrow it's Spanish that they're going to talk more than English there on that. That empires, I wrote a little book about that, a new age of empires. The world tomorrow is not a world of nation states. Sorry, it's a world of empires. And let's hope that it are the good empires and not the bad ones that we, so you can, in Czechia, you can talk about it certainly, as those who have seen in the past. And that is at stake. So geopolitically, that's my main concern. And so in my opinion, without going into the mandate that I have and how we prepare it for the moment, this is also one of the key interests for Europe, I think, the geopolitical dimension. It's not only about trade and internal market and so on, even when, you know, the position of our parliament, the position of the parliament is that the 4 liberties, the 4 freedoms are linked to the internal market. You cannot dissociate this, saying, oh, okay, we this and this freedom we keep, but that freedom, for example, of movement, we can throw overboard. That doesn't work. But the main thing that is that you don't feel for the moment in the debate, and that has unfortunately not played a big role in Britain itself, is a geopolitical dimension. Could Winston Churchill come back? He should have used that as the first argument, I think. I'm not so sure about it. Because in any way, not to leave bluntly, like some of them have proposed to do so. He should not have lied about it in any way.
Well, I think we'll have to take that offline due to the fact that we are coming to end. But I think the budgetary aspect that was shown is an interesting, let's say, sign of a paradox or a catch-22 situation, that in reality you have 0.13 of GDP budget, and you've got many, many more tasks which are basically being imposed by the member states. Fine, if it is ad hoc, we need to generate the financial means, like on the migration crisis. But look how fast the race between the member states to really put in extra money really is. So this is in fact a break that the member states have on implementing the European Union policies. Anyway, I understand from what Guy Verhofstadt has said that the answer to your question is yes, Brexit is an opportunity to get certain things right, which means, and that would be my comment, that in some areas, yes, this is about having a greater ability on the European level to tackle the issues. On some, not necessarily that is the case. Ladies and gentlemen, I know that there were more of you that wanted to table or pose a question, but I'm afraid that both the minister as well as Mr. Verhofstadt have other commitments. In fact, the debate that will start in the Bureau of the ALDE group just in a few minutes will be very much also focusing on what comes next, on a real strategy, and especially at the midterm, basically, of the parliamentary mandate. So what I can only do is thank you for coming, for having the patience with me, for not having sufficient room to table your question. But I'm sure that Guy is not here neither the first time nor the last time, that when we will see him in the position of Brexit negotiator with also the second agenda that he clearly identified now, we will have more opportunities to debate. And I understand that also Mr. Babiš will be around also for the future. So I think that so you will have, you might have a different moderator than me, but the two guys will be around, so I'm sure there will be more opportunities in the future. Thank you for the Institute for inviting us for this 1 hour gap that we had in our program. Thank you.